Hi, this is Kitty Clark from Saint Cloche Gallery at Sydney Contemporary 2019. As you can see behind me, our booth is absolutely buzzing. We've had so much excited interest with our solo artist showing of Evi O's Fantasia, a stunning assembly composed of abstract shapes and bold colour that amplify energy. Sydney Contemporary invited us to present an event on their official opening night celebration, which is one of the most anticipated events on Sydney's cultural calendar. We proudly presented a special panel discussion on the relevant topic, Colour is My Superpower. We chose a brilliant panel of Australian artists and designers who exemplify the topic to discuss how they use colour, how it manifests in their life and work, and how it has the power to affect our emotions and our psyche. They all definitely apply their superpower as a force for good, and they've made the world a better place as a result. Welcome to Sydney Contemporary, everyone. Thank you for joining us this evening. My name is Kitty Clark. I am the director of Saint Cloche Gallery. It's an emerging art, well, we support emerging art, and it's a little gallery located in the heart of Paddington. We're a relatively young gallery. We only opened our doors about 4.5 years ago. And at Saint Cloche, championing emerging artists and connecting them with new collectors is really important to us and to me, as I believe that we cannot have a thriving art scene if we do not invest in emerging artists. So here we are. This is our first time at Sydney Contemporary. I have truly enjoyed the creative journey working towards Sydney Contemporary with Evi O, artist on the end there, who we are exhibiting at Sydney Contemporary, our colour extraordinaire artist, as you can see up in that slide. It's her superpower. So at Sydney Contemporary, we're presenting her bold and vibrant latest body of work and first Sydney solo, Fantasia. Now that we are here, it hasn't disappointed. I am truly grateful for the opportunity to exhibit alongside so many other amazing galleries. It takes a team to bring together a great show. I would like to also take this opportunity to thank everyone that has supported us tirelessly behind the scenes. My family, my team who are working in the booth right now, Nadine Bush, who has helped bring together this amazing panel of speakers, and Tim Ross, who will be moderating this discussion. I'll let Tim introduce the panel, but first, a little bit about Tim. Tim is probably best known for his work on TV and as a radio host of Sydney's number one breakfast and drive shows. He is also becoming increasingly recognized for his interest and passion of architecture and design, particularly modernist architecture. In 2018, Tim was awarded the National Trust Heritage Award for Advocacy, which recognized his activism in drawing attention to Australia's legacy of modernist architecture and promoting its conversation, in particular, the Save Our Cyrus campaign. Well done, Tim. Over the last 6 years, he has performed his live Man About the House show in architecturally significant buildings and homes all over the world, turning each venue into a temporary theatre entertaining his audience, but also giving them inside access to some amazing architectural buildings. Tim's love of architecture and design has led to many speaking engagements, written articles for various publications. He had a two-part series on Australian architecture, Streets of Your Town, which aired on the ABC, and partnered with the Powerhouse Museum, Sydney, when he curated the Design Nation exhibition, which then led to a nationally touring talk. He is the author of 3 books. His latest is titled Motel, Images of Australia on Holidays, which has evolved from his latest live show with Kit Warhurst and was produced in conjunction with the National Archives of Australia. We are so very honoured to have him as our moderator for the Colour is My Superpower panel discussion this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Tim Ross.
Please thank Kitty, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much. She's doing fantastic things with young artists, and it's so important. And so a round of applause for Kitty, who's very much needed. When when they said, they asked me to do this panel, they said I wasn't really listening. And it was like, Ken Doan's got a superpower. Do you want to talk to him about it? And I was pretty excited about it because I had this image of Ken being a little bit like Spider-Man and then, boom, Duna cover, boom. But no such luck. Before we get into these, we'll go through it. We'll meet everyone as we go through to find out about their superpower. Ken, the first time in 35 years that you've worn this jacket.
So trendy, isn't it? I've never seen so many trendy people in Sydney. This is about like an hour and a half before my bedtime. This jacket is old and fuck it, I'm old. But to come here and see this, it's very encouraging about the state of art and design in Sydney. It's great.
Well, it's really good to have you here, Ken. You are a legend. Let's start at the start when you were a kid. Tell us about your earliest connection with your superpower, your colour superpower.
I grew up in Belmore. I used to like to look at books that had colour in them. Like all kids, I like to draw. But I liked those magazines that had flags of different countries of the world or flowers, or things that were a pattern and things that were in colour. And I certainly responded. Like when we move up into McLean on the Clarence River and it would flood and you would see these amazing purple hyacinths floating down a kind of khaki river. I like that. I like that thing. I think all kids are into colour, but for me, I just sought it out and I liked it.
Well, tell us about you here.
Look, this is East Sydney Tech in the 50s. Wearing a bloody tie. That just shows you how actually conservative the art school was at that stage. It was the end of kind of commercial art in Australia and the movement into other things. I got a special exemption to leave school at 14. I went to Mossman High. They didn't teach art to boys. I got an exemption to at least go to the library and look at books on art. They said, you have to give up something. I said, I'd like to give up algebra because algebra and I, to this day, have never, ever had any relationship at all. Anyway, I went to art school. I was there for 5 years. And I think if you have a kid who's interested in arts, like the con, if you're a musician, you go to the con as early as possible. So, yes, that's a wild party in East Sydney Tech, as it was called in those days. We won the Gold Award for Fashion in Australia in 1991, which really surprised me too, because we weren't a traditional fashion house. But this was a dress that Judy had designed, and it came from a painting. I was very interested in Japanese haiku poetry, and so there's this wonderful poem that says, I would learn of their dreams in flowers, but our butterflies have no voice. In other words, it's such a beautiful painting, thinking about how brief a butterfly's life was. Then I made a pretty painting, And Judy turned it into fabric, and then, you know, we ended up winning this award for fashion. Here's a painting called Homework. Everybody's got to do their homework every now and then. And this is essentially what this is. It's a small painting. I did two of them. I simply wanted to make a whole series of different marks. Marks that were interesting enough, you know, to hold your interest. And obviously, if you look at a picture like that, it's already a pattern. It's already a piece of design. It doesn't take a great brain to think that you could turn it into something else. And there it is, turned into something else. And beside it is a very recent picture, only a few weeks ago, where it's called Rocks. And I'm starting to experiment with spray paint and fluorescent paint. But it's the same idea. It's a bloody mark, you know? I'm sure there are lots of people here who deal with very conceptual things, screens. Put your things on your eyes and you look at things. Look, I'm a painter like a caveman. You make a mark on something. Make a mark on something. It hasn't changed for thousands of years.
I mean, so much of your work speaks of optimism. Where does colour come to play with optimism?
The optimism comes because I live in Australia. You wake up in Australia. This is not Baghdad. You know, you wake up in Australia. You know, you're incredibly lucky to be here. And just as a side issue, here's something you could all think about. Australians have already decided that yellow is the colour that represents the country. Go to any sporting event, you'll see us all dressed in yellow. Therefore, what will the new flag be? How will we involve the yellowness into the new flag to represent the country? When we put green and yellow together, it's sometimes we get it wrong. It looks like a bloody pineapple salad. You know, if I was the design dictator of Australia, I'd say, look, here's the green, here's the yellow, move on to something else. Now, it might be that the flag is not green and gold. It might be that it's gold and blue, but somewhere it's going to be yellow. And it's, I think, it's the major design exercise that all Australians should be thinking about.
Absolutely. Ken, we'll come back to you in a second. We'll move on to you, Linda. Good to have you with us.
Hi.
Let's go back to your childhood as well and talk about your colour superpower.
Well... left-handed, drawing already. My father was a printer, so I had a lot of paper, and all my friends would gather at my place because I had the paper. And one of my early colour memories is the Kodak yellow of the Kodak yellow box, because that was one of the things that Dad would bring home, the paper, and sometimes it was the cardboard that had the yellow on the back. And my parents encouraged me to draw and paint, because I think Mum... Well, she did paint much later on, but I think she would have been an amazing artist. So the fact that I loved to draw, I was mad about Walt Disney, and I just used to draw those pixies and started creating little funny frocks for them and things like that very early on.
Were you aware that they were encouraging you perhaps more than others?
Well, probably, because my friends came to my house to draw. And I guess because I had the paper, which I think at the time you didn't really understand that that was... like a luxury, actually.
Yeah. Ah. And tell us about the discovery process for you.
That is one of my blurry photos. I studied photography with Paul Cox at Perantec in 1967, and Carol Jerrems was also in the class ahead of me. And, I mean, the whole thing with photography and Paul and Carol was so inspiring, and they really encouraged me, and just to see... have discussions about no cropping and photography and, you know, how it made me feel. And later on with my, all of that work, one of the main things that I loved to do, because I'm short-sighted, was to get my friends to twirl so that I could get the blurry photographs to have a feeling of the opals and to then try to paint that maybe after, that sort of feeling of getting the blurry colour. This is one of the paintings from 2000 up in Port Douglas when I was invited to redo the furnishings for the hotels that we did in 1986-87, Club Tropical in Port Douglas, and later on we did many, half a dozen of the hotels up there with really colourful, they were mad about the colour, which was brilliant for me, of course, and to make the rooms all tropical. This was one of the reef themes with the coral paintings that matched the hand-printed fabrics that were on the bedspread. So I had an amazing big studio shed space up there, and just I could paint happily away, and I was just so happy.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and what have we got here?
This is actually a real photograph of an opal, probably from Winton, that has, it's a magnified photograph, so that's what opal actually looks like when you've magnified, how many times I'm not sure, but it just represents one of the shades of when you're moving an opal, of how the colours, and I chose these sort of photographs to show how the inspiration of opal has really inspired me with the colour.
It's beautiful. I mean, in a similar, I should ask you the similar question to what I asked Ken, which is about the sense of Australian colours for you. What does it mean?
Well, it means beauty, fun, and I think we all think about what we're going to wear. Usually it's what colour do you want to put on, whether it's black or whatever colour it is. there's a feeling about it that makes you feel good. You have a feeling for that colour, and it's hard to describe why do I want to wear it. Well, hello, I wanted to wear red today with a bit of other colour. It could have been indigo, but that was yesterday when I decided I'd be in my indigo kind of colours. So I think it has a feeling and an emotion about it that makes it happy.
Do you both look at me and think I'm a little boring on the dress front?
Never. No, never. It's practical. Doesn't matter.
But I love seeing you both with so much colour on. It's incredible. Mm. It speaks so much. It's lovely. Have we got another one from you? Is that the last of your slides?
That could be the last.
Okay. We're on to you. Thank you. We'll get back to you in a second. Thank you, Linda. Rachel, tell us about you and your childhood and colour.
Sure. Well, my memories of colour really kind of originate just in the primary school art room for me, because I grew up in a very, very clean house. My mum is Maltese heritage and just loves like clean edged marble everything, and it's just a super minimal but yet spiral staircase. And I just remember like loving home, but I just never quite fit in with my aesthetic. So it was in the primary school kind of art room where I first kind of discovered my style of embellishing and materials that were kind of forbidden from our household because they made such a mess. Like I have a really early memory of, I don't even know where I got it, I must have smuggled it in from primary school, of this kind of aqua green glitter, and we had this very stern brown carpet in my bedroom, and I dropped it on the carpet, and I just remember trying to like frantically like pick it up because I knew I was going to get in trouble because there was glitter everywhere. But the reason I had it was because it was always like something that was so precious and prized, these shiny things that I was maybe a little bit forbidden to have. And every time I had access to it, it was like I was kind of stowing it away, very magpie-esque energy in terms of hoarding these glittery things from a very young age. And obviously this photo kind of just sums up that I think maybe being the second child, my older sister was always so smart and academic and everything. I always just wanted to stand out. Like I was like, any opportunity to have a bit of a show, I would take. And so this is some of my current work, which
Tell us about this.
Well, I'm always trying to capture that sense of nostalgia with my work. I work predominantly with like tinsel and pom-poms, and some might say like quite naive materials. And it's because when I constantly think back to memories of childhood and special, like really the art room for me was a big like time of experimentation and freedom. Like even making like little snuggle pot and cuddle pie dolls and things when I was little. Just memories of like soft yellow tulle and things like that have just continued to be really pervasive for me even today. So I try and just continue to capture that in my work today and toe the line of nostalgia, but bringing it into the present and just pushing them with my aesthetic.
And how did your family deal with the mess today?
Oh, look, I mean, I get a lot of feedback, but my family have always been really good about it. Like, Mum gave me the garage to work in eventually. Like, she allowed me a space. We've just agreed to disagree on what design entails.
In terms of, you're speaking so fondly of your time at school, are there particular teachers that are from that time that are aware of how important it was to your career?
Oh, look, absolutely. I've stayed in touch with a couple of teachers, particularly in high school as well. Like, I think even year 12 art for me was such an amazing year. I think being given those parameters in high school to work with as like projects and given a topic and that sort of thing was always something that appealed to me, because sometimes if you don't have any parameters to work in, I feel like you can feel a little bit lost. Having access to all those materials and being given some instruction, I really responded to well and produced some work that I still think has influence on me today.
Fabulous. Thank you very much. On to Tarlene, and tell us about you and your childhood and colour.
My childhood colour. I can't say that I have strong memories of me being an artist when I was young or had a real drawing to colour. All I do remember is that I liked mixing colours. I really love to, use paint to create new colours. So I really was into getting primary colours and creating secondary colours with it. So in primary art, which I agree with Rachel, my memory of art is contained in the primary room because my mum's very similar. We weren't really allowed to play and make a mess in the house. You know, she was very neat. So it was really in primary school, but even then I wasn't a standout artist. Like, I wasn't really that great in drawing, I wasn't that great in painting, but I loved playing with colour and I also liked doodling. I liked to make designs. So I would draw with usually a lead pencil and I'd make a lot of designs, but my colour play really came with mixing colours.
Okay, and tell us about how it works for you today.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting because, you know, my passion was with food and I guess with what I do for Hippie Lane, it's about attracting people to a healthy lifestyle. And in order to do that, you know, I'm trying to reach people who aren't necessarily healthy-minded. So in order to reach the mainstream, who wouldn't normally or ordinarily eat healthy food, I need to appeal to them. So my strategy was always, how am I going to appeal to people with healthy food? You know, it's really not the first thing you'd go for. And I just used colour.
Did you stumble onto that or was it a...
Look, you know, in the first year or two, it was more about producing comfort foods that everyone knew in a healthy way. That was my first strategy. Then as time went on, I really realised how crucial it was to present food, you know, food as presentation, that there is a styling and there's a plating and we eat with our eyes first. So if I'm going to appeal to everybody here, how am I going to appeal to them by putting kale on a plate? You know, I really need to dress it up. I need to make it attractive. And in order to do that, I need to play with colour. And luckily, natural food is so colourful. So it's really about arranging that colour and making it stand out. So I have a lot of fun with doing that.
Do all your meals look this good at home?
I was going to say, they don't, absolutely don't. I put, you know, this was about 3 or so years ago. This is when I was in a really creative overdrive where every day I would go to bed and wake up and go, how am I going to present it differently today? And being on social media, it's a daily thing. Like, you don't wait for a gallery or an exhibition. You literally are there every day inspiring people to choose healthy. And to do that, I would wake up and think, okay, I'll do this today and I'll use these colours and I'll use that fruit and I'll present it in this way. But for myself, I'm really simple. Really, really simple.
And tell us how rewarding it has been for you to present food in this way.
Oh, it's so fun. It's so rewarding because I finally realised that all those years where I was so interested in design as a kid but didn't have a place for it, there was no place at primary school or high school that had the design that I liked, composition, styling, that wasn't really what it was. Either you were a portrait artist or a landscape artist and you did that really well, and if you didn't do that well, then that was it. So I didn't even think of art at all, but it's been very rewarding. It's, you know, it's reached a lot of people. There's a lot of people who are very interested in healthy food now and who've been able to, you know, this was when it was the fantasy craze, and I found it really exciting and challenging to come up with new colours and new ways of presenting. So that there's more and more people who thought, okay, so it can be fun. For me, that's very rewarding.
That's beautiful. Thank you very much. Yasmin, good to have you here. Tell us about you and childhood and colour.
Hello. Childhood. Well, I came from a mixed sort of heritage. So my dad's Egyptian and my mum's very Australian. She's from Cronulla. And she's white, you know, white skin, green eyes, freckled. My dad's very not that way. And so when I was born, I was so much darker than I appear now. I've lightened up heaps. And and so my first introduction to colour wasn't so much of, you know, colour in the sense of a splash on a paper or the colour of your wallpaper. It actually was the colour of your skin that I felt heavily connected or disconnected from. So growing up in the 80s in Sydney, it was a very different scenario than growing up as a mixed race sort of person nowadays. Mm. So I didn't feel extremely comfortable a lot of the time. So my connection to colour was, you know, always not feeling amazingly, I guess, in place with everybody else. Mm. You know, in the Middle East, you don't have... you're really lucky if you have coloured eyes, and that's blue and green. Brown doesn't... That's not a colour. That's black. So I hope to God, because I've married a British guy who's a beautiful man who's got blue eyes, I'm really hoping that my son or daughter one day will have coloured eyes. So, yeah, it'd be pretty cool.
And tell us, what have we got here? Something there.
Well, my mum loved Ken, and she's here tonight.
Oh,
and
hello.
She's so damn excited to say hello.
There she is.
She's over
there.
Come
and give Ken a kiss. Come on. Oh, you've got no shirt. Oh, okay. Oh, you've ruined everything. Oh, afterwards. Okay.
So we had a couch. We had the Duna covers. We had the placemats. We literally had fucking everything that was Ken. So I think Mum dressed as everything print-wise you had out in the market. So, Mum, good on you. Still got them.
Okay.
Dad flew back to Cairo the other day and he goes, I still think I've got those Ken Doan sheets for you. And I was like, yes, I'd love them.
Yeah. But, I mean, what influence did that have on you?
Well, we left Australia when I was really young and I moved to Kuwait when I was probably 10. And Kuwait, although has no real connection to me, my parents were just there at the time of my birth. I literally don't have any other connection to it. So my dad got a job over there and we moved over from Sydney just after Gulf War and lived there for 10 years. And I remember thinking to myself as we were flying over a very dusty patch, which was literally the entire fucking country. I got down and landed and I was like so excited. This was supposed to be my birthplace. And I remember just feeling so incredibly disappointed by the whole experience because there was no colour. So my immediate, again, connection was lack thereof of colour. And for me, ever since then, I've just wanted it so badly. It's like a, you know, feed me.
Yeah. Tell us about colour in your work today.
So this was from an installation I worked on recently for the National Gallery of Victoria last year as part of the Rig Design Prize. So this was a really strong emotive installation. It was 40 square metres and the brief was domestic living in Australia. And for me, living in Australia was not actually permanently living here. It was memories of conversations I'd share with, you know, my family while I went and visited my grandparents in the bush, and then I'd return back to, you know, Kuwait and, you know, live amongst camels. You know, it was a very different juxtaposition of lives. So this was a really kind of split in half situation of, you know, feeling in one way connected to Australia and in another not so connected, but always landscape being part of it. So a lot of these materials were inherently found within the Australian landscape, and you know, certain elements on the left-hand side, which represents an outdoor setting, was more representational of, you know, Egyptian tomb ceilings. You can't really see from this image, but they're sort of star-studded skies that would take you to the afterlife. And so it all had sort of undertones of both sort of backgrounds, but also reading as, hopefully, as very Australian.
Fabulous. What have we got here?
These are a couple of projects. We do hospitality as well as residential. So the top left is a Edition Roasters down in Darling Square. It's an all-black fit-out. And again, the client was not Japanese, but Australian, married to a Japanese, very enthralled with Japanese culture. And all of his staff was Japanese. And so he really wanted a space that harked back to a Japanese sort of farmhouse experience. So a lot of the techniques that we used within the fit-out were actually ancient old techniques in Japan, including, you know, the great style seating there that, you know, actually one of the staff members cried because it remembered having, like, dinner at his grandparents' house, which was really cute.
Yeah.
And then the other images are from a residential project. Again, I love to use colour in selecting inherent sort of colour within, you know, the material choices. So this is a natural, you know, slab, and the colours within that slab, again, remind me of a landscape. And again, I'm very drawn to those type of material choices that are inherently of a colour naturally.
And what are your clients demanding these days in terms of colour? Where's their head at?
Sydney's pretty hard. If you lived in Melbourne, it'd be really easy.
Yeah.
But Sydney loves wide, and I'm by the ocean and I want, you know, I want this. And I'm like, I don't do that. Yeah. So so I definitely have a lot of people going, but I want it. I'm like, well, I'm not going to give it to you. So it's a very sort of learning process. And I'm, you know, I'm like, well, what were you drawn about our work to make you come, you know, in the first place? And they're like, oh, this and that. And I was like, well, I can do that. It's just, you know, let me do it in a different way. So it's about always educating and saying, hey, there's a world out there. It can be colourful, but it can also be muted as well. And I think a lot of people who have interiors think that you can't be colourful because they just immediately think of primary colours. But there's so many colours for an interior, so many shades and tones, and pattern obviously plays a huge, huge part in the whole story.
And tell us about these wonderful spaces.
Well, the top image was for Hotel Collectionist. So we did a series of 10 rooms, all wildly different from one another. But again, they were drawing on nostalgia. They were, you know, named individually after characters. The top one was actually called Candy Wong or something like that. It was all of them reminiscent of a time or a period or a country. So it did have an international sort of flavour. So the left-hand side, super inspired by the shopping bags. So the ceiling was, you know, hand-painted with a plaid detail. And then lots of trompe-l'oeil effects. So the budget was very, very, very bad on this particular project. But it was amazing because we had to think outside the box. So all the skirting detail, which looks like a beautiful viola slab, is actually all hand-painted as well. And we worked with Elke, who's a jewellery designer, who came up with all of the carpet patterns for Brinton's and was releasing this entire range. And we decided to use 10 of her patterns for each of the rooms. And on the left is, you know, basket weave, and in the middle is a massive terrazzo pattern, and on the right another massive terrazzo pattern but in different shades. So all had a very different language but kind of read the same.
Fabulous. Thank you very much for that. Evi, can you tell me about you and your childhood and colour?
Well, I think my story would be the saddest one because that's the only childhood photo I could master for a good reason. I grew up in Indonesia and my family moved home recently and they lost the, you know, childhood photo box. So that's the only one on Facebook that I could find. But back to my childhood, I don't know, like when the gallery asked me, like, can you find a photo of you, you know, being a child artist, you know, with a paintbrush or something, I didn't remember doing that. I think the closest relationship to color I had was remembering choosing a crayon box of 48 colors instead of 12. So I guess, you know, I did love color. But my family is a pretty typical middle class Asian family in Indonesia, tiger mom. I was really good at piano, maths, oh my god. But then coming of age, you know, I really wanted to be in the basketball and volleyball team. I made the team, but I was always benched. It was pretty sad. So I just left the team and I'm like, I'm joining a band. So I did join a band. I was, you know, a musician for a while. I was pretty bad as well. So I'm like, so I went back to math and end of high school. I got lucky. Like, my parents were like, oh, why don't you, you know, like, we'll pay for, you know, I was very privileged. I'm very privileged. They're like, you know, go somewhere, go to Australia because your uncle's there, so he'll watch over you. He's here somewhere, actually, he's watching me. And study something, you know, you're really good at maths. What do you want to do? Do you want to become a doctor or an accountant? And I said, oh, maybe an economy? An economist sounds a little bit sexier, right? Like, and then at the very last minute, you know, like, I got into the unis easy. I think, you know, like, also education is an Australian import, so I don't think it was that hard. But at the very last minute, I actually switched, and I actually wanted to study art. And mom was like, no, why? Like, you're not going to be an artist. And I'm like, okay, how about design? And she's like, no, you can be an architect. I'm like, but I don't want to. So yeah. She's like, all right, so if you can study design, not art, and if you couldn't get a job after graduation, maybe you come back and I find you a rich husband. I'm like, yeah, sounds like a deal. So I didn't find a rich husband, but I studied design. I get to, have a colourful life, I guess. So that is a little bit of a colour spiel from my end. Tim, yeah. Oh, question?
Keep going. I'm enjoying it. how does it influence you today? This, so much of it.
Maybe we should go back to that slide later, because I think maybe I should have shown the... No, maybe not that one. Maybe that one first.
Okay.
So I'll continue the story. So 17 years old, Evi, in Sydney by herself, studying at UTS. Amazing. I thought I was, design is tricky, but I thought like I should be able to study this. And I was, I was initially crap at it because I was really good at maths. But but then I was really determined. And I think at one point I got really obsessed with understanding composition. I always drew. I went to a Christian school and I always got detention because I always drew when it was praying time. But that's fine. And I kept drawing, but all my drawings were actually black and white until I got bored of it, and I started, where can I go from here? And I just bought like three tubes of paint, red, blue, yellow, the primaries, and started mixing stuff. And when I started mixing paints, and I'm like, oh wait, there's a whole world in this, and that's really when I first, played around with color. But that was just on the side, to pay bills and all that. I have to do design work. So I was working for Penguin Books for 8.5 years before I went out of it, freelance, and then started my own design studio. And these three images are some of our latest works. And I guess with book design, it's a language, I guess. Like, it's a language of telling a story through topography, layouts, and most importantly, color. That's actually a book on color on the left. And the middle one there, it's a nonfiction book on a really cool plant philosophy. And that's a Japanese cookbook. I guess, they're all colorful. And weirdly, I guess our studio is now known for, doing colorful work or expressing stories through colors. Those are actually some of my paintings that have turned into objects or merchandises, whichever you say it. And that's my dog. next one. Oh, okay, back to that. And maybe back to the other one, the first one. Yeah, so that's me trying to look cool in the studio. Someone needs a press shot for their latest exhibition that is on booth 06. So I was doing design work, and I, even though I love, I still love design, I still practice it, there was something that was lacking in terms of expression. I feel like everything was kind of like limited into this 27-inch screen. And it's all, it's actually very, very cool to do colors on screen because you can just click and color turn up. But I miss that physicality, I guess. And when I was a child, I guess I loved coloring before it was a very trendy, mindless, mindful meditation method. Sorry. That's how I started painting, actually. I got bored with doing black and white drawings, and which I wasn't really good at anyway, and I started playing with colors and making compositions. And one day, a curator friend saw a little study in my house. I was doing that for 2.5 years or something, not showing anyone because I'm very shy. And she was like, can you make 12 of those? There's this group show I'm doing. I'm like, okay, sure, I'll do 12. And then 12 turns into 14, and the rest goes on, and you can see there's now a whole room of paintings. That's the short story, Tim.
I'll let you all jump in on this at any stage you feel like it, and if one of you don't answer, I'll just point at you. But do you think do you see the world in a different way to other people? Do you see colour in a different way? There's something.
Me?
Anyone.
Oh, anyone.
Oh.
if you've been at it for a long time, you realise you have to lift the microphone up. No, I think you use your eyes in a different kind of way. I think you... Like, James Morrison's a good mate of mine, and so I'm sure he hears sounds differently too, the relationship of sounds one to another. I'm sure when Linda's looking at into opals, it's giving her a kind of insight and a thrill where it might lead you. I mean, there isn't any rules to colour. You can't necessarily teach it. You can go through all of the colour charts and all of the colour wheels and things like that. But if you look at the great colourists of the world, an American painter called Milton Avery, who's just the most exquisite colourist, you'll find there are still ways of using and putting colours together in a different kind of way. It just has to be something you feel. Can't write it down, can't necessarily find any words to describe it. It's just something you feel.
And does that resonate with you guys as well?
I just want to touch on that as well, because I guess even though you use the same colour combination on something, but if the composition is different, the feeling is also different. It doesn't mean one colour is happy or sad. It's how you use it. It's a language, I think, yeah.
I wanted to start painting in the late 70s, early 80s, because I'm a fashion designer, okay, but I really wanted to paint, people said to me, well, you better go to art school and you'd better study and things like that. And I thought, oh, well, maybe I should. And then I thought, I think I'm just going to pick up the brush, really. Yeah. And it's is that thing, you have passion for certain colours at certain times, different days, you feel different things. And I don't even really know how the colour wheel works, actually.
I think you were saying, you know, do you see colour differently? I think that you get inspired by a lot of things. I think your eyes see, like when I see a sunset or a sunrise, that inspires me to put it into my work. So there was a jar that I was holding up in one of those pictures that was inspired by the mood of the day. There was a rainy day. It was sort of like blue skies, but it was about to get nasty. The clouds were all grey. And I looked at that and I was like, oh, what a beautiful colour combo. How am I going to use that in my food? You know, so when you say, do you look at colours differently? I think you see things. I think it really speaks to you in nature. Just anything that you see, you're like, oh, wow, look at that colour.
Yeah, and I think that's what we'd all like to hear is where you grab that inspiration from.
Yeah.
And different places.
Definitely for me, it's with nature. I often talk to my daughter. My daughter's really aware of colour as well. When we're sitting, we're very nature-orientated. If I was to look outside, we've got a really nice view where we are. And always looking out, going, look at the colours of the sky today. Look at what colours they are. And there's different shades of oranges and pinks at different times. And yeah, it lights you up, makes you happy, you know. There's a real, it's like being mindful and noticing. I think that there's so many times where if you're busy, you don't notice what's going on around you. But when you slow down and take a look, you can be inspired by everything and anything.
What about you, Rachel?
Well, I really agree with that. And I think it's not only the noticing and the seeing the world, but I think it's the follow through and like what you do with it. And then the choices that you make is what makes your work so innately your own, because it, and that's what I find so exciting about colour and inspiration. And everyone here would probably see, you know, a sunset or an opal or something, but with your own practice, you would go and translate it into something totally different. And that's what I find like so exciting about colours and things like that, is that it's like just kind of this exciting, dormant thing waiting to be translated through your own eyes and through your own hands.
Esmond, going back to your, you know, Sydney just likes white. Why do you think that is?
Well, because, you know, you're by the beach, you're floaty, you're white. You know what I mean?
I mean,
but you know what I mean. It's just like, it's like being in Greece.
Yeah.
You wear white when you're on holiday because you're brown as hell and you're looking great. So, you know, everyone's wanting that when they're in Sydney because it's great weather all the time.
But, I mean, you know, can you see Sydney in a different way, though, don't you, in terms of you don't see it as...
Well, I've been living in Sydney for a long time. I'm fortunate enough to live beside the harbour. I was thinking about your last question. I remember 2 days ago, we have a swim in the morning. I was walking up through the beach and I leant down to smell a freesia. It was so beautiful. And I thought, you know, I should do a painting which is called overwhelmed by aphasia. And so I went straight up into the studio. I had the title, I just couldn't get the painting. It turned into something else. I don't know what it turned into. I'll probably go back to it, but you see, there's an exercise where you've got the palest possible mauve moving into blue, and right in the middle of the freesia is the little bit of yellow. But it's the smell, you know? You've got to try and put that together. Look, I don't know. We all make it up. None of us really know what we're talking about. Look, we just make it up.
Oh, I'd love it, Ken.
I just want to say something about...
Yeah.
I don't know how many people have travelled around the country the way that I have, but if you think of Sydney and the colours we've just said, and then you're moving up the coast to Port Douglas and it is actually all green, and you're travelling across through Alice Springs, the blue sky is unbelievable, the red earth is extraordinary, there's Uluru, which is completely, you can say it's amazing, but it is absolutely extraordinary. And then you, I was in Yuendumu near Alice Springs, and the friend art coordinator said, let's go for a swim, let's drive to Broome. A couple of thousand Ks up the Tanami, and that's the most incredible turquoise, different colour ocean, and the red dirt is another different shade of red. It's extraordinary. So our country is full of these extraordinary colours, and it's well worth a drive.
Yeah, I mean, as we go, people going overseas more often and choosing to, because they can. Do you think we're losing a connection with Australian colours?
What everybody's doing and just talked about, I think more people are beginning to feel that they do want to travel more in Australia to see the country, because there's more artists. I haven't seen what everybody's work is, but it looks like, you know, there's a lot of inspiration coming from our country that's coming into it.
We've got time for some questions. Anyone got any questions or statements? We take statements, but prefer not to, you know. Like if you do a bit of Scott Morrison,
just get up on the stage. No one knows what we're talking about, right, Ken? Come on. Oh, come on, guys, seriously.
Yeah, hang on. I'll come down because we can.
Hello. I'm Roger Foley. I've worked for both Ken and Linda. Doing your fashion shows. And I love the way both of you use colour. And I think the way you use colour is revolutionary, because Australia became free from imperial control in the 60s and 70s through your use of colour. And I think that was the most important thing to me. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else got a question? That's all right then, doesn't matter. Before we wrap up, has anyone wanted to make any more statements or things that you heard that resonated that you'd wanted to share this evening?
No, other than the fact that we do make it up, and it's half a conversation. Like you make a painting, it's half a conversation. It's what you bring to it, and it's what you feel about it. But as a country, or as a group, we all cling to the edge of the country. We cling to the beaches, and yet we still have this incredible myth about the feeling of the outback. And nobody knows that better than Linda. The kind of colours that you find in the outback, they're not like any colours you'll find any part in Europe. I think it's a very optimistic time to be an artist in Australia or to be involved in the arts in Australia. And one of the reasons, I think, is mass communication can tell us what's happening in other countries of the world. You can find out what people are doing in Belgium. You can find out what they're doing in Reykjavik. And so, like when I was a boy, the Woman's Weekly was in sepia, in fucking sepia, you know? there wasn't any colour magazines in Australia. So, as Roger kindly says, over these last 30 or 40 years, there have been some amazing changes in attitudes of colours. But as I said at the start, it's always half a conversation. It's what you feel about it.
Do you guys all feel that similar optimism?
Yeah, definitely.
Yes.
Absolutely. I think a lot of people look to Australia now for inspiration in every field, not just, you know, art or interiors or food or fashion, everything. I think it's really positive.
I mean, our climate sort of probably drove our take-up with Instagram, though, hasn't it? Because, you know, like places like the UK, that's so great, you can't take the same amount of photos. It doesn't have the impact. And in the same way, it allowed people to see what we were doing in other ways that you couldn't. I remember, you spoke about to me before about how it generated, you know, you took Australia to the world back in the day, didn't you? You know, and if you were around today...
We were hopeless. I'll just tell you this. We were hopelessly knocked off by... Like, if you do something that's really simple, then it's very easy for people to copy it. And as you might remember, in the early 80s, I did do some drawings of Sydney Harbour because it's a wonderful place. And, you know, somebody bought me in a T-shirt which, from that day, which was perfectly printed line for line of my original drawing. I think the thing that gave it away is underneath where I'd written Sydney Harbour, they'd written Gulf of Thailand. Well, somehow this is a bit of a clue, isn't it? That, you know, this might not be the real thing. Yeah, look, I know that there's a program coming to the ABC fairly soon about mojo. The 80s are a very optimistic time for Australia. We won the World Cup. The cricket was very good. We won the America's Cup, not the World Cup. Very optimistic time. And then, of course, leading up to the Olympic Games in the year 2000. I hope we'll find those times again, right? I was struggling a little bit at the moment. But look, you would not want to live anywhere else but Australia.
But I think I might just add one last thing about Australia. I think the multiculturalism as well does affect and make a positive impact. I think Yaz might agree, but when I'm travelling or I'm connected to my own heritage, I'm born and raised here, but it does come up in the work that I do, and I think that being such a multicultural nation, I think it really does play with the kind of work that we're creating. So although we live and breathe Australia, there's a long line of multicultures that actually make it up, and I think that that's also very present in the art that's out there today within Australia.
Absolutely. Well, thank you very much, everyone, for coming along. I have to remind you that the Saint Cloche Gallery is at booth CO6, so we'll see you there afterwards. Please thank the panel, ladies and gentlemen. It's been fantastic.
Such a powerful language, and we love communicating it through Sydney Contemporary 2019. We can't wait till next time.